Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to this edition of Disability Viewpoints right here on SBNN-TV. My co-host today is none other than Joan Willshire. Joan, who are your guests today?
Kyle Shelton. He's the Executive Director of the University of Minnesota's Transportation Centers for Studies and Research, and we're going to talk about rural transportation in Minnesota. It should be great to learn more about what's happening in transportation.
I have a panel of three from MNSILC. That's a disability independent living organization that is 51% disability populated, and they're appointed by the governor, so they have a pretty heavy gavel here in Minnesota. So we'll talk to them in just a minute, and we'll open up another edition of Disability Viewpoints just straight ahead right here on SBNN. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. We have we're talking today about MNSILC independent living centers, and we have Deborah, Linda, and Robyn. I'd like to have all three of you, can hear me, introduce yourselves first before we get rolling. So let's begin with Linda Lingen.
Okay. Again, my name is Linda Lingen, and I have been a part of the IL movement and the Minnesota Statewide Independent Living Council since the dinosaur times, way back. Since 1989, actually, is when the first council was formed.
Okay.
And I was a part of that whole effort of forming it. So I've been a member as an ex officio member representing state services for the blind, and more recently as an actual voting member since I've retired now.
Well, great. And then Deborah, welcome.
Hi, I'm Deborah Gleason. I am the past chair of the Statewide Independent Living Council. Mm-hmm. And I've been there about 3 years. And I joined because I decided it was time to dedicate part of my life to making the world a better place instead of always fixing someone's bottom line. So that's
great. And then Robyn, we want to introduce you also.
My name is Robyn, and I have been on the council for 4 years. This will be my fourth year, and my 3 years reapplied. I am the current chair on the council, and I joined because I wanted to help others with disabilities and help other people learn different ways that we do things and inspire people.
Okay, and I think that answers our first question then. What challenges does MNSILC face in the very near future? Linda.
Well, I tell you, one of the things I think we're going to face is that there are going to be more services needed for people with disabilities and for people from other marginalized communities. And we will have to continue as advocates to move forward into the future. We can't look back. We can't look beside. We have to look forward. We will need to focus on the rights of people with disabilities and people in marginalized communities. And we need to continue to advocate with our legislators and with other community organizations for the rights of these folks.
Okay, and the next question is for all three of you. What have you enjoyed the most about serving on this council? And we can begin with Linda, then we'll go to Robyn, and then Deborah.
Oh, gosh, there's so many things I've enjoyed about this council. Probably some of the big things for me are our educational efforts, both with legislators, with other community organizations, and with ourselves. I've also enjoyed, I serve on the reports committee. So every year we do an annual report that kind of highlights the services and the wonderful things that the 8 Centers for Independent Living across Minnesota have done this past year. And then that is distributed to legislators, to county and city officials, to anybody that we can possibly get it in the hands of. So that is another big thing. And probably the last thing I'll highlight is that we have worked diligently, I will call it, that's the word, with the Secretary of State's office and Rev Up Minnesota this year to get out the vote, to encourage people to vote. And we will probably continue to work with those organizations in the years to come to assist people with disabilities to get out and vote.
The change coming in January 2025, really, in our political front, our legislature, our Senate, our House, maybe, do you see any changes as to how you approach the legislatures or the reps or anything now? As to how your organization approaches?
What's the word that Roosevelt used to say? Speak softly, but carry a big stick. That might be what we're going to have to do in the future.
That's exactly right. Hey, how do people apply to serve on the council? And that we want to ask Robyn about that one. So how do people apply to serve on the MNSILC Council?
So you go to the Secretary of State website, which is sos.state.mn.us, and then you're going to click on the boards and councils.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hi there.
Okay. And then once you fill out your application, about how long does it take to apply before they let you know that you can join or you're going to be?
Okay. So Joe and I will get the notification of your application, and then we set up an interview, which usually we try to be on top of that, where 2, 3, 4 of us will interview process. Usually within, I would say, a week to 2 weeks at the max. Usually we're pretty good with that part. And then we recommend you to the governor's office. And the governor's office, now the time frame on what they choose to have you on the board, that's an up in the air one. I don't know how to better say that one besides that's an up in the air.
Yeah,
one.
That's exactly right. The reason I ask the question is because when I applied at the Minnesota State Council on Disabilities, Governor Ventura was governor then. It took me 11 months to get on, but I stayed all 12 years. And it was just the greatest experience of my life. I got executive council experience and everything like that. I did everything I think there was to do. And I'd say that whether Joan Willshire was here or not, it was just a great, great experience. And even the work on the state fair was a blast. So there you have it. And I learned how to testify and how to handle the House and Senate too. So that's why these boards are so important, is my point. So, okay, any last comments from either one of the three of you on something we may have missed or something you really want to say, especially as the budgetary year approaches here in January 2025?
I do want to note that 51% of our council is people with disabilities.
That's an important thing to know. And how can people reach out to find out more about MNSILC and contact you? And if you'd appreciate if you would repeat the information twice in case the people don't have a pen and paper at home, that would be great. And I wouldn't give out your home number, but if you have office phone numbers or emails, that's kind of what we're looking for.
Deborah, you want to take this one?
This is Deborah. What we've got is a phone number of 612-518-1497. That's 612-518-1497. Mm-hmm. Or you can email at MNSILC, so that's MNSILC 1215. We don't know why it's 1215, but that's what it is, at gmail.com.
Okay, very good. Anything else I may have forgotten or we may have missed? Or
well, this is Deborah. There's a couple of little things I'd like to sure. add if we can have a moment.
Absolutely.
In addition to, you know, our council being 51% of people with disabilities, the Centers for Independent Living also operate under the rules of having 51% people with disabilities, and they are usually disability-led. So disability-led is critical to the independent living movement as a whole. Independent living is so much about choice and about removing the barriers, and you've got to have the people with lived experience helping to make the decisions and making things work. And I agree completely with you, Mark, on the skills that you learn, like leadership and different just types of training. And especially as you work on a state plan, you learn strategic planning and how to work with other people. It's a tremendous,
you know, we did all that. And it is so important to know that. And for the change in my life, it was at the right place at the right time. It was just a great experience for me. I can't say any more about it.
Agreed.
You know,
now, I just want to add the final comment, the closing comment.
Okay.
Remember, folks, we are.
We got about 3 minutes left. Yeah. So.
Then we are alone. So I encourage you all to become a member of the Statewide Independent Living Council and make a difference.
That sounds great. Anybody else have a comment? We got a couple, 3 minutes left. Nobody else has anything to say. Look at that.
We have a lot to say.
For the first time in 26 years, they're all quiet.
No, this is Deborah. I would like to thank you for this opportunity. We really are trying to get out there, and we love partnering with other disability organizations. And you know, we can't lobby because we're a governor-appointed council,
right.
But we can support, we can educate, and we can advocate. So. You know, totally reach out to us if you're looking for someone to help partner. We're working on things like a speakers bureau for education, so I'm super excited about what's coming up.
Would you be interested? We're going to be looking for sponsors real soon for this. Would you be interested?
You know, I definitely think we can put that on our agenda to talk about.
That sounds great. With that, anytime you want to come back, you're always welcome. Just let Joanne Erbus know. She's kind of my assistant on this project. Joan Willshire is another big help here with this show. So reach out to any one of them. And by all means, we'd like to have any of the three of you back anytime. So you're always welcome.
Joe's a massive help to us as well. So
She's just a wealth of knowledge. It takes a village to do this, but I don't know where we'd be without her. So we're all pretty lucky. Okay,
agreed.
Folks, thanks for being on. And we'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints in just couple minutes. Stay tuned, please.
Today, we're talking rural transportation. For many people with disabilities, transportation in general is a challenge. And then when you move to the outstate area, rural communities, it can be even more of a challenge. But with us today is Kyle Shelton, the executive director of the University of Minnesota's Center for Transportation Studies and Research. He's going to shed some light on us about rural Minnesota and transportation in general out in the outstate area. So welcome, Kyle.
Hi, Joan. Thanks for having me.
So I know in this last year here in 2024, you've been focusing a lot of your efforts on looking at rural transportation in Minnesota. Why did you decide to focus on that?
Yeah, thanks, Joan. So our thematic focus for the center in 2024 is called Rural Needs and Statewide Answers. And I think you already touched on some of that, which is everybody, no matter where they live, relies on transportation for a huge amount of their day-to-day lives, right? Mm-hmm. Getting to their activities, getting services and goods brought to your home, whatever that looks like. And there are unique challenges for urban and suburban and rural areas. And one of the things that often happens in transportation and other sectors is that a lot of the attention maybe focuses more on like a population center, for example. How do we move folks within Minneapolis? And obviously that's still a really important mm-hmm. question. But often what happens is that folks in greater Minnesota or more of the rural areas maybe don't get as much attention on the research side of things or some of the obstacles or hurdles that are discussed in a more urban setting are maybe not applied in the same way as they could be in a rural setting. And so we wanted to just kind of shine a little bit of a spotlight on some of those challenges and work with our partners across the university and folks like yourself and others who are asking questions about how transportation systems are working in greater Minnesota.
Great. Well, and I think in the general public, people don't understand the difference between rural and metropolitan transportation, let alone when from the disability perspective, how it varies so as well. So have you created some projects that are really focusing on looking at transportation just in general and then the aspect of people with disabilities in it as well?
Yeah, I think you're right. There's a lot of differences between what services are available and are not. So, for example, obviously lots of larger cities have a dedicated transit authority that is serving a general jurisdiction. That's not always the case in greater Minnesota. There are lots of greater Minnesota transit agencies that do have a relatively large territory and that provide a range of services. But one of the things that we know to be true is that a lot of those services are less frequent or are, you know, call for service that require multiple days planning in advance. Some of that's true for urban areas as well, especially for folks with disabilities really needing to schedule a ride well ahead of time, which, you know, is not how everybody prefers to move. We don't want to wait that long for our needs, and we don't necessarily want to be so dependent on scheduling something out multiple days in advance. So in terms of some of the projects, you know, we continue to work with our partners in Grand Rapids on the Go Marty shuttle, and I think y'all are talking more about that in a couple weeks, so I don't need to go in huge depth there, but that's a great opportunity to sort of think about a smaller community. What are some of the ways to address the gaps that folks have in getting through and around the Grand Rapids area? Those vehicles are explicitly made to be accessible for folks with mobility devices, and it's been one of the major users of that system, and so far it seems like there's been a great deal of success. So we continue to work with those partners on evaluating that program and supporting that program. We've also hosted a couple of events generally that I think have just sort of talked about some of the mobility challenges. One of the things you and I talked about was when you think about transportation and provision in greater Minnesota, it's not only that there aren't necessarily the same available services, right? Like the transportation agencies may not have the same coverage. There's also just a range of different programs to try to navigate, I think especially for folks with disabilities. And that's everything from non-emergency medical transport to particular waivers or programs that folks might be involved in. You are kind of accruing different obstacles as you think about that, right? It's hard enough to navigate that when you're really close in the metro area, for example, with lots of services to you. For folks in a lot of the greater Minnesota areas, there may be one service provider who's mm-hmm. able to accept a particular type of waiver or take a particular type of trip. And so that obviously creates a really big challenge. And I know that's a lot of what a range of agencies, everybody sure. from non-emergency medical transport to the health department are dealing with and thinking through how do we really provide that service to folks in rural areas.
Right, right. Well, let's keep going down your list of the projects and really, you know, dive into some of the projects so we can learn more about what's been going on out there with some of the projects.
Yeah, I mean, so we talked about Go Marty. I think one of the other things that some University of Minnesota researchers have been working on and in support of are some MnDOT work around something called Moving Greater Minnesota Forward, which is a project of the Office of Transit and Active Transportation. They've been really trying to think about how to solve some of the challenges for rural communities and what types of programs to support there. Again, it's a range of kind of trying to support some entrepreneurial work of folks who are interested in everything. You know, I've talked with some of the leads there, everything from, again, providing more accessible NEMT transportation all the way over to, you know, this might be an area that's not served by a private taxi company. What does that look like? And how do we kind of tap the opportunities that transportation network companies have unlocked in other areas? But while we do that, how do we also think about some of those challenges, overcoming some of those challenges for folks with mobility devices in particular? When, as you and I have talked about, and I know others are abundantly aware, those accessible vehicles are not always available. And if they are, it often takes a long time for those services to reach folks who need.
Okay. So you know, were there any particular huge challenges when you're looking at putting together these projects that really stands out in particular?
I mean, I think something that we've noticed, and I'll share this video that is a project that we connected with a resident of Lake Crystal on. He's a low vision individual who has talked a lot about his challenges in finding and accessing transportation. I think the thing that I would highlight across all of the work that we've seen done or the conversations that we've been a part of is kind of what I've already touched on, is just sort of the unique challenge of transportation in Greater Minnesota, where so many folks with disabilities rely either on their own vehicle if they're able to secure one of those, or on friends and family, because the kind of patchwork of other services is just so spread thin and not available at the range or frequency that folks need. And so I think time and again, we're seeing that challenge of if your own vehicle breaks down, or if you don't have the ability to repair something, or you know, you need to get to a medical appointment and the friend who you typically rely on is not available that day. There's just so many obstacles in terms of what is the right
system
to put into place to support those folks. And that's something we see sort of across the board when we're talking about Greater Minnesota transportation. And that's not just for folks with disabilities. I think there's a range of people who do not have access to a vehicle or do not have stable connections with family and friends to get them to places. And I know those transit providers are constantly working to think about how to provide that service better.
Would you say transportation in the rural area has strengthened and gotten better in terms of, like, there's more transportation, it's reliable and accessible? Or would you say it's about the same that it has been since the last decade?
I'm not sure that I can speak directly to, like, its improvement. Mm-hmm. I guess what I would say in terms of the on-the-ground performance, what I would say just in my time at the university and some of the projects and conversations I've been involved in the last 4 years is that I think it's getting a deserved amount of attention. And that's from state agencies and groups like MCOTA, the Council on Transportation Access. I've had multiple conversations with transportation agencies or the organizations in Greater Minnesota that run especially non-emergency medical transportation, where I think a lot of people are recognize the level of the challenge and are really grappling with what are the ways to address it and augment the existing programs that we have. Mm-hmm. Because like we've talked about, right, the reasonable expectation that somebody in a rural community can get to a medical appointment, let's say if they live in northern Minnesota and they need to get to Duluth, that shouldn't take weeks and weeks of organizing. And I think everybody's sort of at the place of, we recognize that it's a real challenge, and augmenting the services that are there is a big, I think a really clear priority for a lot of the groups who are working on it.
Are there any particular geographic regions within the state that have greater challenges than other portions of the state, would you say? North versus South?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an interesting question, Joan. One of the pieces of research that our accessibility observatory is working on right now, and one clarification when we use accessibility in that context, it's about access to destinations. So it's not the more typical application of folks with disabilities being able to access particular places. But that being said, one of the things they've been working on is, for example, looking at if you need to get to a Trauma One center or a key medical center, what does that look like in different places? And we have a range of other destinations. That work's still being done and is still reaching its conclusions right now, but they shared some of that at the most recent Center for Transportation Studies research conference, which happened just last week. And I know, just kind of recapping what I saw in that presentation, unsurprisingly, some of the places where there are the biggest access challenges, just purely based on where resources are located, are sort of in, especially on the medical side, I believe it was southwestern Minnesota, and sort of north central were places where it takes people a long time to get there, right? And if you think about it in that regard, it's also where there are lots of challenges in getting services to people, right? Because the distances are just greater. The sites that people are trying to access are further away, the destinations. And so it's definitely a high hurdle.
Would you say when you're looking at the challenges too, is the getting to the work probably one of the greater pieces of the challenge? or just trying to have a normal sense of living, you know, being able to go to church on Sundays, getting to the grocery store, I mean,
sure.
Or is it all at kind of at that high level of a challenge?
Yeah, I mean, I think you're making a really great point. Obviously, there's mm-hmm. lots of different trips that people make, and they all have a similar set of challenges. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that with medical transportation in particular, it gets a lot of attention because there are so many programs that are in place to help folks with different disabilities or different circumstances reach those appointments and reach that care. And so I think it's also one of the places where there's a huge opportunity to continue to streamline that and make that system work. But I think your point about, you know, folks just getting to employment or to education opportunities or recreation and worship opportunities, that's obviously just as important to individuals' quality of life. And I think that's where you see, you know, I'll use the Go Marty example again, or other right. projects just working to think about how do we move people day to day and minute by minute. That's really critical because, you know, it's none. I am fortunate to not have to schedule my mobility to, mm-hmm. you know, my day, my work at the office today, right? I get up,
right.
get here, well, with multiple different modes, and that's
absolutely.
Not the case for
everybody. So it yeah. sounds fabulous, all the work that you've gotten done here. And we look forward to learning more about what the Centers for Transportation Studies is going to do. Thanks so much for coming on. And
of course,
we'll keep moving on and being good in the transportation area in Minnesota. Thanks
Absolutely.
Again.
Thank you, John.
Yep. And we'll be right back after these messages.
Well, again, this has been a quick moving half hour, and we want to thank the folks at MNSILC for being on. We hope that a lot of you at home, if you're interested in applying to their board, can now apply, and they're going to be doing a lot of good things in the 2025 legislative session, it sounds like. And so we hope you've gotten a lot of information. If you do need more information as to how to apply, they gave you a phone number. You can contact them or an email address. Please feel free to go ahead and do so. Joan.
Well, another good episode on my end as well here with Kyle Shelton from the University of Minnesota's Transportation Centers for Research and Planning, where we talked rural transportation, and there is a lot going on. He's got a lot of good pilot studies and so forth, where we're going to learn how people with disabilities and others are going to be able to hopefully get better and more transportation out in the outstate area.
Great. By the way, that brings us to this point. Coming up on when we're on next time with Disability Viewpoints, I'm going back in time. A friend of mine, Phil Krinke from the Snelling Companies, is going to be on. And you say, why the Snelling Companies? Well, if you look in the recent paper, they donated a heating and air conditioning system to one person's house who was a veteran and who has a disability and has had some other problems. We'll tell the story next time about the great things that the Snelling Company is working on and has done, along with the Lennox dealers. And so it'll be a good fit, a great heartwarming story to end this coming year. And so we hope you'll stay tuned for that. So for Joan Willshire and the entire team here at Disability Viewpoints, I'm Mark Hughes. And as always, thanks for watching. You're always welcome. We'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints. Bye for now.